In this video, we'll be talking about a continuous probability distribution called the Laplace distribution. So we say a random variable x is distributed as Laplace with parameters mu and b, where b must be greater than 0, mu can be any real number, if it has the following PDF. So the PDF here is given by 1 over 2b, e to the power of negative quantity, absolute value of the quantity x minus mu, all divided by b. Okay, and since we don't have any brackets and there's no zero otherwise term here, we assume, and it's true here, that x can be anything on the real line. It can be anything from minus infinity to infinity. So it's similar to the normal distribution in that regard, in that you can plug any value of x you want. Okay, so let's do our routine things. We're going to find the expected value, variance, and moment generating function, and then we'll see a quick application to a previous type of random variable, previous distribution we have discussed. All right, so let's find the expected value. We start by just writing the routine formula that we always write. So I'm going to pull this 1 over 2b, which is a constant, right out, and then we have integral from minus infinity to infinity, remember it's over all real numbers, x, because we want to find the expected value of x, times the rest of the PDF. So e to the power of negative absolute value x minus mu all over b dx. Now this absolute value is kind of bothersome, so we would like to eliminate it. So we kind of need to observe the behavior of this thing. So we see as we traverse from minus infinity to infinity, when we hit mu, something changes in the absolute value. So let's say we're below mu. Let's say we're in values of x that are less than mu. So if that's true, then when we do x minus mu, we're going to get something negative, so this absolute value will need to flip it. In the other case, if we're above mu, then we're going to get something positive, and then this value that we get, x minus mu, is going to be the correct value, so the absolute values aren't even needed in that case. So let's reflect that. So we're going to break up our integral into two integrals. So we're going to break it up into the piece that runs from minus infinity to mu, and then the piece that goes from mu to infinity. So really, we haven't changed anything, because we're just taking it one part at a time. So now let's see in this region, where we have everything is less than mu. So if it's less than mu, then the absolute values need to flip. So we take this x minus mu, and it's actually mu minus x, because that's what the absolute values do to it. But then this negative reverts it back, so it's actually still x minus mu over b. So that part is taken care of. Now in this other part where we have everything is greater than mu, we're going to have that the correct value is from the start. X minus mu is correct since that's already positive, but then this negative sign will flip it. So we're going to have mu minus x to the power of b. So now we have two integrals to deal with. So let's try to make this a little bit simpler on ourselves. We see that this e to the power of x minus mu over b can be kind of rewritten as e to the x over b, e to the minus mu over b, right? Just using the laws of exponents. And this e to the power of negative mu over b has nothing to do with x, so I've just pulled it out right here. And I've done a similar thing for this e to the power of mu over b right here. So all we have to deal with is really this integral from minus infinity to mu of x e to the x x over b dx, and this other one, the integral from mu to infinity of x e to the minus x over b dx. So this is just a routine calculation. You're just using integration by parts. So the details are listed here, and the substitutions you want to make are u equals x in both cases, and in this case you want dv equals e to the x over b dx. Here you want e to the minus x over b, and let me make sure to put my dx. Okay. So, and then the root, you just do the calculations and you get that the first integral here comes out as mu b e to the mu over b minus b squared e to the mu over b, and the second integral here comes out as mu b e to the minus mu over b plus b squared e to the minus mu over b. So it looks like a little bit of a mess, but it cleans up really nicely after we take into account these constants out here and then this constant out here. So on the next page, I have the very simplified version. So this first line is the simplified version. Let me explain where it's coming from. So we have this e to the minus mu over b, and it's being applied to this text right here. So we get that this e to the mu over b, this e to the mu over b cancel over with this e to the minus mu over b just to become a 1. So really we have mu b minus b squared, and that's what this whole thing is. In fact, it'll be nice to write it. So this whole thing is just mu b minus b squared. And likewise, this does a similar thing. We have this e to the mu over b being applied to this, which cancels with this and this. So it's really, it's mu b plus b squared. So here we have mu b plus b squared. Okay? So then we see that this minus b squared and this b squared cancel nicely. So we just have two copies of mu b, and we divide by 2b, so really all we have is mu. So it cleanly simplifies to just mu. So the name mu, obviously, it often stands for mean, so we kind of suspected that might be the mean from the beginning. So indeed it is correct. Now we need to find the variance. So we're going to use our typical variance formula, expected value of x squared, this random variable, minus expected value of x squared. This we just found was mu, so we have minus mu squared here. So now the task remaining is to find the expected value of x squared. How are we going to do that? The same exact way. So I've already started the simplification. I pulled out the 1 over 2b, and this is the same exact formula as before, except instead of x, we have x squared in both cases right here. So now, this mess down here is just more integration by parts. Here the substitutions you want to make are u equals x squared in both cases, and you want dv equals e to the x over b dx and e to the negative x over b dx, and you carry on like that. And it's not too bad because you need to do the initial first term, but when you get to the second term, you might think I have to use integration by parts again. But for example, notice this guy that I've put in a little bracket down here. This integral, which is minus infinity to mu of x e to the x over b dx, is exactly this integral right here, which we did our integration by parts already. So you can use the previous answer in your current answer and get some nice simplifications. So we see that this first integral right here comes out as this right here, and the second integral right here comes out as that right there. Okay, so I take those and I plug them right back in here, and actually let me make a quick note. This is not exactly the integral that's this. What I did a simplification in my head, which I really should have written down. I did the same thing because I have here e to the x minus mu over b, which is really e to the x over b, and I can pull the e to the minus mu over b out. So I've done that here. And the remaining integral that would have been left, so the integral would be integral from negative infinity to mu of x squared e to the x over b dx, is what this is right here, and similar for this integral. Okay, so then I do our simplifications here, and we just keep going like that, and we get that expected value of x squared is mu squared plus 2b squared. And remember, don't forget to subtract off the mu squared, so the mu squared gets subtracted off, and we're left with 2b squared. Okay, so the variance of a Laplace distribution is given by 2 times b squared. So we see that kind of similar to the normal distribution, the expected value depends only on the first parameter. In fact, it is the first parameter, and the variance depends only on the second parameter. But unlike the normal distribution, the variance is not just the second parameter. It's a function of the second parameter, namely it's 2 second parameters squared. Okay, so the next thing we need to do is find the moment generating function, and that turns out actually not to be so bad at all. So by definition, we need to find the expected value of e to the sx. So again, I'm doing the same thing. I'm pulling this 1 over 2b out. I'm going to start by just taking it over the whole real line. So it's still in its absolute value form, and we have e to the sx, since that's where we're trying to find the expected value. So now I'm going to go ahead and do the standard thing. We split it up into two so that I can get rid of the absolute values, and this can become a lot cleaner. As I did before, I've pulled out the e to the mu b and e to the minus mu over b, e to the mu over b here. And what we're left inside is just e to the, here I've combined the e to the sx and the term that would have been left. So by term that would have been left, I mean e to the x over b and e to the minus x over b. Since they have this x in common with this e to the sx, I can go ahead and just combine them to make it cleaner. So here I've combined them, and we get two different coefficients for x up in the exponent for e. So now we're going to try to evaluate them. And these are really easy. These are just standard e integrals. There's nothing fancy going on. So I just evaluated both of them right here and plugged them right back into the formula in the brackets here. So we have 1 over 2b and the answers to the two integrals. So we have b cancellations up here. And we see that what I've done after that is push this e to the negative mu over b and e to the mu over b right back into these guys. And after some simplification, you see that they're actually just e to the mu s, both of them. So you can pull that common factor out. And then this fraction right here actually reduces very nicely also. And what we get in the end is just e to the mu s over 1 minus s squared b squared. But there is a nuance, because always in MGFs, you need to be careful. Are there steps I'm doing where the answer would only hold under a current assumption, under a certain assumption? And the answer is yes. And where we need to look mainly is this step right here. When we're evaluating these integrals, notice that if we had here this step right here, so I've taken the integral at this point, and I plugged in mu, and I'm plugged in negative infinity. Now what I want is that when I plug in negative infinity, I want this to vanish, because the other option would be that this would go to infinity, in which case none of this stuff would converge at all, and I wouldn't even have an MGF, so I don't want that. Now, in what cases of s would that be possible? So if I plug in negative infinity for x, then this thing had better be positive, so that this whole thing can go to zero. So I need that sb plus 1 over b has to be positive. So let me write that one condition. So I have sb plus 1 over b needs to be greater than 0. And that stated in a different way is just that s has to be greater than minus 1 over b. That's one condition. So let me make sure, minus 1 over b, okay? Now we get a similar condition on this side right here, because here I'm also plugging in mu and infinity. So if I plug in infinity into here for x, then we have a little bit of a different story. I need this to be negative, because here I was plugging in negative infinity. Here I'm plugging in infinity, so I need this quantity right here to be negative so that the whole thing can go to 0 and we can get convergence. So what I need also is that sb minus 1 over b needs to be negative. So I need sb minus 1 over b has to be negative for this all to work. And this is just also saying that s has to be less than 1 over b. So I have these two conditions. I have that s must be greater than negative 1 over b, and s is less than 1 over b. And compactly stated, that's exactly that absolute value s must be less than 1 over b. So this is a condition for this MGF to hold. If we don't have this condition, then one of those integrals goes off to infinity, therefore the whole thing doesn't converge. So we only have an MGF in this case. And if this is the case, then this is our MGF derived right there. Okay, so the last thing I want to talk about is the relation to exponential distribution. So we always want to try to relate these distributions, because none of them are just distributions in their own right. They're always connected to different distributions. So here we'll look at a little expression with the exponential. So we're going to say x and y are both distributed exponential with the same parameter lambda, and furthermore, they're independent. So we want to know right now, what is the difference between x and y? So we want to know, what is the distribution of the difference between x and y? So if you watched the previous video on the chi-square distribution, you know about the MGF inversion property, which means that if you have one distribution and you find its MGF, you have a different distribution and you find its MGF, and those MGFs are the same, then this property says that those distributions are the same. So if we can go ahead and calculate the, if we can find the MGF of x minus y, and it looks like the MGF of something else, if it resembles the MGF of something else, then this must be distributed the same as that something else. So let's go ahead and try that theory out. We want to find the MGF of x minus y. Okay, so we do it by doing expected value of e to the s, that random variable x minus y. We split it up like this using laws of exponents, and since x and y are independent, the expected value of a product is the product of the expected values of them. So we have expected value of e to the sx times expected value of e to the negative sy. Now, we know the expected value, we know the MGF of a exponential, it's just lambda over lambda minus s, under a certain property, of course. So this guy, this first guy, only holds if we have that, written up here, that if s is less than lambda. So this is one condition that must be true if this is to converge. Now this guy, this you might be confused at first. You're saying, oh, that's negative s. Do we know how to do that? Well, we actually do. Pretend this is just our s. So since s is just arbitrary, we're going to let s be negative s in this case. So, but because of that, we need to kind of say the condition that has to be true. So remember, the condition for the exponential is that s, the thing you're plugging into the MGF, has to be less than lambda. So the thing we're plugging in here is negative s. So we have negative s must be less than lambda, also known as s must be greater than negative lambda. So this is our two conditions. And if we take them together, compactly stated, it's that absolute value s must be less than lambda. Okay, so this is our main condition. And now we can go ahead and write these two MGFs. So the first one is lambda over lambda minus s. The other one is lambda over lambda minus s, otherwise known as lambda over lambda plus s. So together we have lambda squared over lambda squared minus s squared. So remember, our goal here, we have found the MGF of this. So now we're just going to try a shot in the dark. So this is kind of not a shot in the dark, I'm telling you the answer, but we're going to see why it's correct. So we're going to consider random variable z distributed as Laplace with mu equals 0, and we have that b, in this case, is going to be 1 over lambda, where lambda is the same lambda as this lambda up here. So MGF of this random variable, we just found the MGF of, we just found out how to find the MGF of a Laplace random variable. So if we plug in 0 for mu and we plug in 1 over lambda for b into that formula, we're going to get 1 over 1 minus s squared over lambda squared. Simplifying this, it is exactly the thing we have up here. And furthermore, the condition is the same, because remember, the condition was that absolute value s had to be less than 1 over b. And in this case, b is 1 over lambda. So 1 over lambda is lambda. So this is just lambda. So we have the same condition here as we have right here. So by the inversion property of the moment generating function, we see that since these guys have the same MGF, the distributions that they came from must be the same. So the distribution this guy came from was Laplace 0, 1 over lambda, and the distribution that this guy came from was x minus y. So using that property, we see that x minus y is distributed. We can get rid of the question mark because now we know it's distributed as Laplace 0, 1 over lambda. Okay? So we see that the difference between two exponential random variables with the same parameter is given by a Laplace distribution. So it's very cool how these things are very connected with each other and stuff like that. So hope you learned something with this video, and until next time.